Our next session is focus session 8. We are going to interchange the sessions. Focus session 8 we are going to have, and then we have focus session 7. I would like to request Dr. Nitin Burkule to enlighten us in this session. I would also like to request the panelists, Dr. Shourangsho Chatterjee, Dr. Shunib Banerjee, and Dr. Indranil Dev to be present at the dais, please. May I request Dr. Shourangsho Chatterjee, Dr. Shunib Banerjee, and Dr. Indranil Dev to be present at the dais. No, she's not there.
Dr. Indranil Dev, Dr. Nandita Chakraborty, Oito, Dr. Nandita Chakraborty, Dr. Indranil Dev,
yeah, I think we start.
Hello.
Please.
Respected
go ahead.
Chairperson and my dear colleague, we'll go through this interesting thing because I think this is our regular problem, that the situation given is an elderly patient with a prosthetic wall at aortic position, recently operated. They are given 3 months, but I think I'll take it from 3 months to 1 year because you know that's quite fair. And he's presenting with an heart failure symptoms. Okay, that is the situation. Now, before we go into the situation, let us quickly run through the facts that we call the aortic stenosis moderate or severe depending upon the mean gradient 20 to 40 and more than 40. And we assume that the AVA will be 1 to 1.5 for this moderate level of gradient, and it will be less than 1 for more than 40 mm of HG. I think that is little debatable, because you can have an wall area less than 1, but your mean gradient may not be 40. Okay, that is too much of wishful thinking. And secondly, you use the continuity equation where you have got stroke volume at the peak, which is by the LVOT into LVOT radius square into 3.14 LVOT VTI divided by aortic VTI. And you have the Gorlin's formula, which actually goes in a different way. It takes flow rate at the peak and velocity at the denominator. And the flow rate is taken by the stroke volume, that is cardiac output divided by heart rate. And then you divide it by the systolic ejection period. That way you get the flow rate. And then you divide it by the velocity, which is assumed from this particular constant into the square root of mean gradient on the cath. So this is how the Gorlin's formula goes: the cardiac output, heart rate, systolic ejection period. This gives you the flow rate, and 44.3 into the root mean gradient gives you the velocity. So anyway, we'll start with the cases. Now what I'm going to do is I'm putting two cases, two elderly, but instead of gentlemen, I kept two elderly ladies. So the Mrs. A and Mrs. B, and I'll just quickly give you the clinical features. Now, Mrs. A is 87 year old, and she's body surface area is 1.8. She had a degenerative AS and MR. Her angio is normal. Of course, CT angio is normal. She has done a tower 3 months back. She's NYHA class 3 after spending 20 lakh rupees. She has two episodes of CCF still before the tower. And her BP is 160/70. She's a non-diabetic and she's CKD. While Mrs. B is 62-year-old lady, body surface area 1.4, she was a known case of rheumatic aortic stenosis and mitral stenosis. Her angio was normal. She had undergone an AVR and open mitral valvotomy 1 year back, but that in a government setting, and she has got a metallic prosthetic wall. She is NYHA class 3 dyspnea on exertion presently. She had one episode of LVA, pulmonary edema, and her BP is 110. She is non-diabetic and she is not CKD. So I'm presenting these two patients little bit because you know then we'll have more discussion. And so the thing is, I will ask the panelists now, should we go directly to the present echo data, or would you like something more from these patients after presenting the clinical data? Should we go for directly the present echoes, or do you want something?
By this time, if you can keep the previous history on the
You want other previous history, yeah. So would you like to have something more, or shall we start the echo immediately?
So we would like to
please come to the mic.
Yeah, her creatinine is 1.8. She was 1.8.
1.8 in this lady is stage 3.
I think you give, I give mic to Dr. Mohan so that he will not have to stand.
I would certainly like to know what is there in ECG of two patients.
ECG of the patients, yeah. So this is Mrs. A is on a permanent pacemaker. I think somehow I didn't put it here.
And pacing,
I'll show her ECG.
Pacing in the right ventricle regularly?
Yeah, she is asense V-pest.
Asense V-pest. And the second one?
The second one is normal sinus rhythm.
ECG?
Narrow QRS complex. I'll show the ECG.
That makes a huge difference in our thinking.
Exactly. So the thing is, before when a prosthetic wall comes, I think still be clinical before we touch the patient for the prosthetic wall evaluation. Because this lady, you can see this particular kind of an degenerative ASMR is very likely to have a CHB. And actually, before 1 year before TAVR, she had a pacemaker, but it is running in VDD mode, asense VPS. So she has got a LVVB. I'll show the ECG later on. So the most important thing is we still want these basic things because they are breathless. So we just want their hemoglobin, thyroid levels, creatinine, how well the BP is controlled, because that elderly lady is going to have a high systemic vascular resistance. They are the typical features, and whether they also had the other problems. Now let me tell you, their hemoglobins were corrected, thyroid was normal, especially for that elderly lady. She did not have an OSA. Her blood pressure was well controlled, though she was 160-80 at presentation, but otherwise throughout the year at least we were giving her good vasodilators. And most important thing is, before we touch the patient of prosthetic wall, we should know what type and size of the prosthesis was put. Because the moment we start getting the gradients, then we get confused. Because many of these prosthetic walls, especially the metallic ones, are notorious to have the residual gradients. So let me tell you the type and size of the prosthesis. So Mrs. A, obviously she has a self-expanding core wall of 26 millimeter, which is actually good size. And Mrs. B has got an OmniScience 21 AVR. Now, as I told you, she goes through the Rajiv Gandhi Arogya Yojana, so she doesn't get the latest generation bileaflet. And she has got an accepted aortic gradient, which is an accepted gradient for a 21 OmniScience AVR is 50 plus or minus 3, mean 28 plus or minus 2, and the manufacturer's effective orifice area is around 1. So if you take her body surface area, which was 1.4, and if you divide it to 1, actually you have got this wall area of 0.8. Now this is interesting that you see the manufacturer's effective orifice area and divide it by the body surface area before even you touch the patient. Okay? And you should know the nomograms of their peak and mean gradients.
But that will lead to a moderate prosthetic mismatch.
Correct. So so this is how we call it. So I think probably she already has got a smaller wall for her body surface area, and that to a single disc old generation wall. So let us go ahead. So the thing is, even before doing our present echo, I think very important to look at the serial echoes, especially for the metallic prosthetic wall, because these three things are very important. The preoperative echo data to know whether they were in a low flow, low gradient, and the pre-discharge echo data, because that will tell you the footprint for especially the metallic prosthetic wall. So I think before we start the echo scanning, we should have their pre-op and the pre-discharge echo data. So let us go for the for aortic prosthetic evaluation. I'm talking only aortic, I'm not talking of mitral. So when this patient comes with a symptom, would you do a fluoro first or echo first? Only for the aortic metallic I'm asking. I'm not asking for the TAVR patient.
So actually my way of doing it, we do it simultaneously. The patient is waiting, another case is done for echo, we do a fluoroscopy first. In case the lab is busy, we do echo first and then do a fluoroscopy.
Yeah.
But we always do it together, same day, same examination.
We may not see the aortic valve very well, but we may not visualize the prosthetic aortic valve very well, but we definitely would want the transvalvar gradients and the other echo parameters.
I think these two points are very important because in mitral, it is very easy to see the double disc or single disc in if you take a proper view. Aortic, very difficult and very important to have both. They are not competitive at all, especially for aortic position. One gives you anatomical and another gives you the functional information. information, okay? So it's better to do the fluoro and the Doppler on the same day, okay? Or rather, if you received him first in the echo lab, send him to fluoro after you finish, or the other way around.
Where are the labs?
Pardon?
It all depends on which flows are the labs. The flows are the same lab, then the way I do it, whichever is available, do that first.
First. So we are on first and third floor. So we do on the first floor and then send for third floor.
But for complete information, you need to have a TTE followed by TE.
I think, so the thing is, the panelist raises a question whether you will do a transthoracic, then transesophageal and then fluoro, or would you do the transthoracic and fluoro first? That's your
I'll go for transthoracic followed by transesophageal.
Would there be any increment in the yield by a transesophageal? Once you have got a good TTE with
I would do the fluoro first before transesophageal echo. Because anyway TE you will have to wait for the next day. But I think fluoro gives a tremendous information, and this, though the CT is a very good evaluation, it's very expensive to do the CT for this. So anyway, both are required.
Sir, if it is an acute onset shortness of breath.
No, the
fluoro, if it's an acute onset shortness of breath, then we are thinking about stuck valve, fluoro comes first. Otherwise, TE gives you both information of fluoro and echo, because it shows the valve, it shows the movements, it shows the perivalve, everything.
I doubt whether on TE you really can see the motion of the leaflet so well, as you see for mitral. Mitral it is beautifully seen, but in aortic, I'm pretty sure many times on the TE also the movement of the leaflet is very difficult to see. And whether it is acute or chronic, anyway we will have to see the the leaflet motion. So that's why I said specifically for the aortic. In mitral, many times you really don't need, because you see beautifully the leaflet motion on TE or on even on transthoracic very well. So now this is the omniscience wall of this patient. I think how many of you feel that this disc motion is normal or abnormal? I'll show you another one also, because see, what you always do in this, you know, many times what happens is we tell the technician to just take the images, but many times they take images where it is not exactly perpendicular to the disc and you may not see the disc also. That can happen. So it is better that you supervise while he's taking the images. So this is the disc. So do you think this disc is normal or intermediate or very bad?
No, this is Omniscience and Medtronic valves. Earlier generation Medtronic are the two who are tilting disc valve. So tilting disc valve, you can see only one disc which is tilting.
Yeah.
But
this is a single disc valve. Yeah.
Yeah. This is suboptimal seems to be.
Opening excursion is
definitely.
So the panelist it should be vertical suboptimal. But this is not absolutely stuck, because the patient would have been very bad.
I don't think that there is anything wrong with this disc. Our difficulty is all mono disc valves, whether Bjork-Schelley or Omniscience, it is said that they should open 60 degrees. In 60 degrees, which view of fluoroscopy?
Yeah, that is also true.
This is opening around 30 to 40 degrees.
So what happens, you can run through every 15 degrees craniocaudal. What I find it, whenever I find around 45, I will label it as normal. So this looks like about 45 degree opening. I do accept there are other problems which we need to address too.
Secondly, there is no, at least there is no rocking motion of the annulus. But the thing is, as how I go about is generally, I ask him to keep on rotating the gantry till you see only a single line as the disc, and I think that may be a perfect angle. Now, this is not the single line. You can see the thickness of this. So probably I think the previous was, I think this was the best. This was the best, where you can see it as a single line, the leaflet, and this is the opening. So anyway, so why I want to say it's all qualitatively we are looking at it. So there is a difference of opinion that this is adequately opening, and there is a difference of opinion that probably it is suboptimal. Okay, so let us go ahead. Mrs. A, obviously this is a self-expanding core wall, so I don't think we should do a fluoro in her case, because the leaflets are going to be bioprosthetic, and those bioprosthetic failing in 3 to 4 months, I think you would think of thrombosis, so you are not going to see anything on the fluoro. So just I am showing it during implantation one, just to show it, that's all. But other thing, I think fluoro is definitely not indicated in her, but at least I want to show you the MAC, okay? Not this MAC, the mitral annular calcification. So let us go ahead. Now let us go for the proper evaluation of aortic stenosis, because we want a pre-op echo before we go for the prosthetic. So what are the mandatory reporting parameters in the aortic stenosis? That is, I think, very important teaching point, because we do many times very cursory studies.
Can I go back to the previous fluoro?
Yeah, this one.
So this is about this obese lady who is 80 years old.
Correct.
And she has a VDD pacemaker, if I can see very correctly.
Now,
issues is that I will leak the ECG, whether it's still SSVP or not.
I'll show you the ECG.
And that is very important, and whether she is developing intermittent atrial fibrillation or not. Because this lady is, as you mentioned very categorically, she is in CHF, and the other one who is lean and thin is in LVF. So CHF with a CKD with obesity, here the things comes of pulmonary hypertension, OSA, or a rhythm abnormality and a diastolic heart failure more often, rather than, I mean, as of now, at this point of all, the suitability of TAVR versus SEVER runs in this way that they produces less PPM. I mean, transaortic valve replacement produces less.
So we know that that lady has a lot of comorbidities.
Here, CTPH also has to be considered.
Pardon?
CTPH has also to be considered.
CTPA may be the last option.
Yeah, there's a lot. So she's a real sick lady. There can be a lot of comorbidities. Paroxysmal AFib is absolutely likely. But I'll show you the ECG is perfectly ASENS VPES. So anyway, but here the fluoro was not required. That is what I'm trying to tell. So that's why I've shown it actually during implant. Now, I think very important for those who are doing the aortic stenosis, I think there's a mandatorily you will have to report the body surface area, the blood pressure while doing. Heart rate you don't have to mention because it is seen on the screen. But BSA and BP very important, LVOT diameter, stroke volume and stroke volume index to body surface area, LVOT VTI, aortic VTI from the aortic jet recorded from apical right parasternal window, very important. And I'll show you for the second case. Transvalvular flow rate. What you have to do is you have a stroke volume, just divide it by the ejection time and you will get a flow rate. And I'll show you the importance of that. AVA and AVA index to body surface area, qualitative description of valvular calcification, and obviously the LV related things. So, and LVGLS. Now let us go for the pre-op data of BSA. Now here I'll go slightly faster because there are lots of images, because there are two echoes, one in February 16 and another in December 16. I'll just go fast, but I'll give you the measurements at the end. But you can just get a qualitative feel of it. And this is her X-ray, and you can see the normal sinus rhythm and the ASENS VPES. And these are, this is her February 16 echo.
A
is there, I think intermittently sensing, because some of them are coming after the keras.
What was the indication for the PPM?
I think probably there is an intermittent sensing of the AVA, because it's a single pass lead. And single pass lead are known to be very notorious, because sometimes they will sense the AVA, sometimes they will not sense the AVA.
Dual chamber, no?
We are pacing. So obviously that is going to geoparadise this myocardium. So let us go ahead, and this is February 16 ECG, and I think we'll just go through, run through it fast, and I'll give you the measurements, but you can just observe it. And don't blame me why she was put for a TAVR, because obviously a very rich family want to do anything possible. I'll give the measurement, so you don't have to, you have the LVOT and aortic. Now this is, I think, the next one. I think this is December 16. So this is the next, after 1 year, not 1 year, January to December. So it is almost 11 months. Okay, and, but the thing is, I'm going to show the measurements for both, and that is very interesting. Okay, so that you saw the aortic, you saw the PR, you saw the tricuspid regurgitation also. Okay, and I'll come to the measurement. This is tricuspid regurgitation, and you can see the TR jet almost reaching 4 meters there. RV taps perfectly well, and this is the MAC, and this is the MAC, everything. And I'll just go ahead, let me go ahead faster. And this is the congestion IVC pleural effusion. Now this is interesting. Now see, this lady at February 16, her transvalvular flow rate is 200 ml per minute. See, ideally you should have at least 250 ml per minute. So she's on a disadvantages there. Stroke volume index is 35. Her peak and mean gradient are 77 and 49. So she's like low flow, high gradient. So she is not a low flow, low gradient. She's low flow, high gradient. And the whatever, the heart rate, you don't go by it because this machine always gives the wrong this thing. So this is the AVA. Now interestingly, just look at this value, and I'll show you the December value. Interestingly, the stroke volume is 69. At 63, 69 probably interstudy variability. But the stroke index has increased to 48 ml, while the flow rate has dropped to 197. How do you explain that? I'll just go. This is 63, 35, 69, 48, and this was transvalvular flow rate was 203, and it is 197. Pardon? How do you expect that? No, I don't think there was any change in the heart rate, because as Dr. Mohan said, it was almost VVI pacing, so it won't going to change.
Now, if
it.
The stroke volume is normal and the flow rate is decreased, you have to consider the ejection time.
Correct. No, but the thing is, see, the problem is like this. This lady in 9, 10, 11 months with recurrent admissions, heart failure, with nutrition going down, her anemia. Weight is dropping, we are diuresing her. That's why the BSA is coming down, and that's why you are suddenly getting so much change in the stroke volume. I don't think there is any change in stroke volume, but the BSA comes different because she has lost weight. She has lost her muscle mass. But the flow rate is, that's what I want to tell you, that the flow rate is probably much more important. So because actually her systolic ejection period is increasing. So that's why actually there is a drop in the flow rate. So we should not go blindly that 35 ml per meter square kind of a thing. And what happened is actually why this lady you had was full of life. You know, even with this kind of heart failure, she will go to the Yeur Hills, which is near Thane, that Boreal National Park, and she will feed the monkeys, she will feed the birds. So that's why and she would also even write the checks for her servants. So I think that's why the family was insistent. The owners of big malls, they were insistent that something you should do for the wall. Anyway, now the same lady, this is her CT to show you the LVOT. Now one can see that this diameter is 17 and this diameter is 23. So that brings me to the question, how inaccurate we are on two-dimensional echocardiography. And somehow I have, if you try to do the 3D LVOT and this kind of a view in this kind of patient, I never get good image. I'll ask Dr. Mohan, with that kind of calcium, somehow that LVOT views on 3D are notoriously bad. I don't know why.
I think, but you keep cutting sections. When you don't see calcium, try to get there. You are. I know you might say, I'm going towards sinus.
Yeah.
And you have only a 5 millimeter, and how much you can cut to go there.
Yeah.
I try my level best to get rid of the calcium, get an orifice, measure, and measure its circumference.
Yeah.
Or measure its area, as you call it.
Correct.
Yeah, area, rather than taking diameter. Diameter is a business, different business. So nowadays, in any case, we should insist that if you are using 3D, don't talk of LVOT diameter. Just talk of LVOT area.
Area.
And multiply by VTI to get the stroke
exactly,
volume.
Exactly, because this is oval. Why put it pi r square? This is oval. And this is the source of all the error of this and the problem with low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis. Now, see, this is what was her CT. And CT gives a crisp images. And the thing is, better you go by the perimeter, because by that perimeter, she had this 26 millimeter chosen. So let us go for the pre-op data of Mrs. B. Now, I don't have her moving images, but I will show you the LVOT and aortic peak and the aortic duration, and I'll just go back, and I'll show the measurements, because I could not get the moving images. Now, this is, her LVOT was 20 millimeter, body surface area 1.4. And these are the VTIs. Peak by mean gradient was 54 by 33. Of course, she had a mitral stenosis, rheumatic heart disease. Peak by mean gradient was 54, this thing. Stroke volume 52, index to 35 ml, cardiac output this much. Ejection time 0.28. Transvalvular flow rate 185, AVA 0.6. And she has a perfectly normal. What I want to insist you is that she had a mitral stenosis. That is why probably she is a low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis. So this is a different variety of low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis than what we saw in the elderly lady. Okay, that is what I wanted to insist upon, is because the other wall is probably causing the issue. I think any opinion from the panelist? Don't we see always especially when there's a double wall lesion, I think you always get a kind of a low flow setting in this our mitral stenosis patient who are generally very thin, they have got a small body surface area.
So
the LVOT of 17 millimeter is unacceptable. Yeah. This is 20 millimeter with body surface area. This.
And
because anything below 20 millimeter, I think we are wrong only on the echo.
So, one of the things suggested is if you are getting LVOT less than the valve area, always take the valve outer annulus as the surrogate for LVOT. So I will take a surrogate of 2.1 for her, and that will raise the stroke volume.
This is pre.
All right.
I'm not talking about
okay,
it.
Okay.
No, because this is the gradient is quite, this is her basic gradient, but she had a mitral stenosis here, na? Because she had afterwards gone for OMV with the AVR. So this was pre. So that is the importance that you have to have the pre data, and we know that both were low flow, high gradient, and this was probably low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis. So let us go for the low flow, low gradient. This is the definition that less than 1 square centimeter, stroke volume less than 35 ml per meter square, and the transvalvular flow rate less than 250 ml, and the mean gradient by 30. This is the definition. So let us go for the present echo. But before we go for the, now we are having present echo with the prosthesis in. Okay, what we saw was before prosthesis. Now what are the mandatory reporting parameters in the prosthetic aortic wall? And I think we'll just know the checklist from the panelist. What would you like to have in a prosthetic wall? We had their fluoro. So what is the checklist would you have?
So you would like to first at least have the 2D data, whether the valve leaflets are mobile, whether it's rocking, whether there's any leakage, paravalvular leak or regurgitation is excessive.
Correct.
Next, we would go over to the Doppler data. We would like to know what is the peak gradient. We would like to know what's the mean gradient. We would like to know the ejection acceleration time.
And
then, of course, we would probably also want to know the velocity index between
the DVI. Doppler index. Yeah, correct.
And effective orifice area.
EOA, perfect.
And heart rate,
Yeah, exactly. So I think this is mandatory. Of course, I put it old INR values also because we should know that. And let me tell you, that's INR values for the patient with prosthetic wall, Mrs. B was perfectly fine for the last 1 year. I'm giving her for 1 year and the other one is 3 months, okay? And there was any visible clot planus on transesophageal echo. So acceleration time, DVI, expected and measured EOA, both should be told. See, the expected one from the manufacturer and the measured one EOA is also very important. So also for the peak and meningocele, expected and measured. Just remember that the gradients and the EOA, expected and measured, both should be in your report. Okay, the one who is reading cannot again go back and find out what is expected gradient. You should be giving it then and there. So both are important because as you know that the calculated EOA, if it is less than the reference EOA, there is a chance of prosthetic stenosis. If they are the same and still the gradients are high, then probably we are looking at a patient prosthetic mismatch. So let us go for the present echo of Mrs. B. That means the 62-year-old with a, you know, the metallic aortic valve and the ones. We are not going first for the other one. So just go through the echo first and I'll show you the measurements later on. So you can just have a feel of the echo. You can see that the OMV looks perfect, LV looks perfect. And that is the close-up of this. This is the close-up of this thing. And then I just go ahead and this is the disc valve there. And the, here you can see both the commissures are very well split. But look at the hypertrophy at the end of 1 year. And look at the cavity size in this lady. And this is her TR, and the TR reaching somewhere near 3 meters there. And this is the mitral wall gradient. And this is her aortic LVOT. And the acceleration time, 92. And this is the gradient from the right upper parasternal. And if, did you see the gradient when it was done from the four chamber view? Okay, this is the gradient when you did it from the four chamber view, and the gradient that you did it from the right upper parasternal view. See the difference. Okay, that is why it has to be evaluated through all the particular ones. Okay, and this is the ascending aorta, which is 39 millimeter, and this is the mild mitral regurgitation. And on the T there, we could not find any panus there. Okay, and these were the gradients reported throughout the 1 year. They are going from 40, 60, 64, 57, 44, 15, 38, 39, 39. You really can't make out anything, though she had 4 reports in last 1 year. Because your present report is like this, her BP is this, her LVOT VTI is 18, stroke volume is 60 ml, her stroke volume index is 40 ml, aortic VTI is 118, DVI is 0.15, peak by mean gradient by right upper parasternal is 118 by 66, acceleration time is 92, and the calculated one is 0.6. Okay, now, this is the expected gradients. These are the expected gradients of 50 by 30 and mean of around 30, okay, somewhere around 50 to 30. And her expected area also, if you index it to the body surface area, would have been somewhere around 0.6 to 0.8. Now, let me come here about the, we know that there is a pressure recovery phenomena in this metallic prosthetic valves, okay. How would you know a part is explained by a pressure recovery? I don't say that 100 gradient you can't explain, but a part will be explained by the intraprosthetic pressure recovery. So how would you calculate that pressure recovery in this patient? You are not going to take an LV gradient, you are not going transseptal and take an LV gradient and aortic gradient and then find out and get the pressure recovery. So my question is, how would you know the pressure recovery in this particular 21 omniscience valve in this patient with this stroke volume?
So you can use the energy loss index that would be valid here. The other point is based upon the fact that monodisc valve have 70% gradient as a result of pressure recovery, I will actually get the mean gradient down by 70% and recalculate the aortic valve area. If that looks acceptable to me, I leave the patient at that level, and the symptoms could be because of multiple other reasons. I know that she's normotensive. I can't explain LVA. The mitral valve has a problem.
The mitral valve is opened properly.
But her LA pressures are very high.
There is a patient prosthesis mismatch. I think is quite acceptable in this case because the LVH should have regressed. It is still significant. But I think the very high gradient we are getting, 70% of them are because of pressure recovery.
Intravalvular pressure. See, the thing is, when we have a native wall, we generally look at the aortic root and the aortic wall area, and you have got a formula to get a pressure recovery, idea about the pressure recovery, and you can subtract it. Okay, you have got the ascending aorta dimension and the aortic wall area dimension, and then you have a formula.
There is a formula.
In prosthetic wall, it is very difficult.
There is a formula with the effective orifice area divided by the aortic ascending aortic area into 1 minus.
Correct, but that is only for the native wall. That's not for the prosthetic wall. So the thing is, I go it this way. I don't know how correct it is. I go this way. I go by the Gorlin's formula. Now, in this patient, you know the stroke volume from Doppler. You know the manufacturer's aortic wall area. Just think that this is not a prosthetic wall, and this is a natural wall with that particular valve area of say 1 or 1.1 as the this one has given, the manufacturer has given, and then you have got the systolic ejection period in your hand, and you can just get the mean gradient, which can be, and then you subtract it from the expected gradient. I think that's a pressure recovery. I think probably they may be doing it much more meticulously by the instrumentation they may be doing it. So
somebody says that, look, I put a 21 side valve to your case and you get a 0.9 area. Why do you put it?
Yeah, that is also true. So the thing is, here actually the mean gradient would have been approximately 20, while the nomograms say that this mean gradient would be anywhere from 30 to 35. So probably there is a, I think the pressure recovery may account for not more than 15, 10, 15, 20, not more than that probably. In this case. Because for this stroke volume, if you put it here, and then probably if you put the manufacturer's valve area, I think you are getting a mean gradient of 20. And while the nomograms of normally functioning valves of Omniscience 21 are 50 by 35, peak by mean.
See, the problem is this valve is opening very eccentric.
Yeah.
And eccentric valves have double convergence. So you will get huge velocities. which are absolutely meaningless.
So the point I want to bring down here is that there is a pressure recovery inside the prosthetic wall. We have to be very careful, especially double disc also. You have got a very high velocity jet between the two discs, while it is different at the lateral orifices. So also in a single disc, there is a small orifice, there is a large orifice. So you don't know which velocities you are picking up. Okay, so remember there can be some amount of pressure recovery there. So anyway, so the thing is, now this is the this one is the okay, now this, these are the probably the causes of high gradient in this patient. So I will ask the panelist, what do they bet upon in this particular patient? I have given you the values, I have given you that probably there can be a chance of pressure recovery, I showed you the disc movement, I showed you that her INR is perfectly normal, I showed you there is no LVH regression, and she had definitely LVF, that all of you pointed it out also, that she had a pulmonary edema with her mitral wall being normal. And she is normal sinus rhythm, I couldn't show her ECG. Measurement error you can say, but the thing is I'll tell you, I have myself done the echo, so.
This is which patient?
This is the second patient. The 62-year-old lady with the RHD and the, you know, small LV size and other things. DVI was 0.15. And her acceleration time was 92. You will never get those perfect values that are there in the guidelines, okay? So the thing is,
was the latest INR available?
I think probably.
The latest INR was okay.
Pardon?
INR
was normal, and even 1 year record she had perfectly normal.
She has a perfect.
Perfectly normal.
So measurement error is not the issue at all. No, I am coming from the below because probably
no, when this panacea is unlikely, but I think can be panacea.
What we, before the surgery is being done, what we should do, we should probably not give a just a geometrical planimetry of a valve saying that this is the valve area, number one.
Pardon?
Just a valve planimetry of the valve area. Ah. That days is over.
Correct.
You for cannot the, do it for the aortic valve. Ah. Planimetry, even the native, I am saying. And you should do three values and then sum up for these things, or you take a single value?
No, there are always, we as a routine, we take five values and average them. Because that's the only way you can improve your interstudy variability.
Absolutely.
All aortic dimensions, LVOT, VTI, aortic VTI, 5 bits. Okay, that's our standard. So thing is, I personally thought that there was a PPM, and probably there is some panus development, because I also thought that the disc is slightly opening less and the gradients are not entirely explained by PPM or intra-prosthetic pressure recovery, and I think there is some amount of patient-prosthetic mismatch. So the thing is, this is just to bring out the the controversies and challenges in management. Otherwise, we feel everything is so simple, but it is not so simple. That is what I want to actually bring it out. So there can be a controversy between this diagnosis. Okay. But let us see the guidelines, that when you have got a peak velocity of this, you look at the Doppler velocity index and acceleration time less than 0.25, more than 100, and less up, more than 0.3, less than 100. These are the concurrent values. When they are concurrent, it is very easy. Because once they are both concurrent, that means this is less than 0.25, this is more than 100, definite obstruction. When they are concurrent either way, that is the DVI more than 0.3 and the acceleration time less than 100, again you know that this can be just a hyperdynamic circulation or patient prosthetic mismatch. Problem comes when they are discordant. Now that, and you will always get discordant values in real life, okay?
With some form of patient prosthetic mismatch, and also the disc is not opening properly.
Correct.
You can have the combination of the both in this case.
Possible. So that is what I'm thinking. It's so complicated in aortic prosthesis. But when you have got discrepancy of AVI and AT, then there's a problem. Okay. In that case, what happens is you are not measuring the LVOT diameter properly, underestimated LVOT VTI. And when you have got a discrepancy in other direction, that means this is more than 0.3 and this is more than 80, go for 80. Because acceleration time increment is hallmark of a stenosis. Okay. So go for 80. So that means your DVI was wrong because the LVOT was small. So you took up a very large velocity time integral because of flow acceleration. So go back. So your echo measurements go wrong in the LVOT, and that causes all the confusion. Okay. So let us go the bottom line. Probably likely that she had also had a PPM, and probably also she had a PANUS. Okay. So let us go ahead for the present echo of Mrs. A. The same, there is a nice, you can see the tower wall there. Okay, the leaflets are opening well. I'll show you on this thing. There is, in this are self-expanding walls. So, you know, there can have a little bit of paravalvular leak, but then it, see, there is a paravalvular leak. But you don't have to worry because they keep on expanding and they obstruct that paravalvular leak. So that cannot be probably one of the reason. The gradient is perfectly fine now also, 25 by 12. Remember, she started at a gradient of something like 80s. And so the thing, and she has got a TR there, she has got a mitral regurgitation there, okay, and she is still in heart failure, okay. Her PA pressures are the same. The tower doesn't seem to have made any difference for her, okay, any difference for her, but there is no thrombotic occlusion of the tower wall. Thrombotic occlusion in tower wall is coming up as a new entity, new problematic entity, because they are not on anticoagulation, they are very elderly people, okay. So the thing is, you can look at this, that she had this abnormal pacemaker. This is the recent one. So the bottom line is, Mrs. Okay, A seems to have an intrinsic, very advanced heart failure. So it's a very advanced HFNEF. She seems to have severely unabated mitral regurgitation. That is also taking away her cardiac output, because there's a MAC, there's a severe MR. You really can't do for this MR. There is a CKD, anemia, frailty. She had a pacemaker-induced LVBB. So the thing is, if you look at the data of patients who have, because this is a very common combination, that calcific AS and MAC and MR. So if you put a TAVR, very interestingly, some of them still have, though they have got a higher 30-day mortality, 1 year follow-up, the MR actually improves in almost 55% of the patient, because you take away the afterload. Okay, that is very interesting. So you may not give up, but the improvement is more likely if the gradients are high and it is more of a functional MR than the structural MR. Okay, but remember, half of them can have an improvement in MR if you do a TAVR in presence of AS and MR, and this is the one. So there is this enigma of paradoxical low flow, low gradient AS, because here actually, if you see, both were low flow situations. One had still the gradients maintained, while the rheumatic lady had a gradients which had dropped down. Now these are the, so in these patients, the surgery still remains a class B indication, because there are lots of comorbidities in these elderly patients of heart failure with normal EF and calcific aortic stenosis. And most important problem is that some of them can still be pseudo-AS. There are erroneous echo data, and entirely because of your faulty LVOT measurement, that brings down the stroke volume, that brings down the long VTIs, and some of them are already advanced HFNEF, so there was the TAVR doesn't work in this patient. So the thing is, it's better that we go for multimodality evaluation in these patients, and I would like the panelists to just highlight whether one of these multimodalities may be useful in these patients with low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis, whom you are thinking about the TAVR. Would you like to comment on one of these multimodality evaluations? I'm not saying imaging, because there's a biomarker also.
This MRI is important to see how much fibrosis already has been taken place. That progress is important.
Is the ejection fraction normal?
Perfectly normal, highly hyperdynamic. Yeah. No, they are all paradoxical.
Then dobutamine stress echocardiography is not advisable. Dobutamine stress echocardiography is not advisable.
Yeah, DSC in presence of paradoxical low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis is very debatable, because when you start dobutamine, they already have small LV cavity. Actually, their stroke volume drops down. So it is useful in those classical low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis. But I think CT has got a very good role.
Calcification, we can show how much dense calcification.
So if you at least, if you have a very severe calcification, the pseudo-AS part is, ruled out. And biomarkers, anyway, they are in heart failure, so I don't know whether that really works.
No.
So I think probably what works is a CT and gadolinium MR, because they characterize valve and myocardium. Okay, in these patients where you are having this HFNEF and this thing, so I would like to tell you that TAVR is not all panacea, okay? Do not, when the patient is spending 20 lakh rupees, still don't give him a reassurance that they are going to be perfectly fine, okay? These elderly people of low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis who are undergoing TAVR. Thanks. Now, any questions from the audience?
So what would you do with patient B?
The patient B, actually, as I told you, sincerely, I was thinking there is a PANUS. So I asked her for a redo AVR. to which she has declined. So I did her cardiopulmonary exercise test. Her peak oxygen consumption is only 12 ml per kg per minute, which actually, you know, in heart failure patient is that you get listed for the transplant. So she is so bad. So I told her that she should go for an AVR. And about the class, the Mrs. A, the first TAVR patient, she passed away after 6 months post TAVR. And at home, she passed away. She never got relief from her congestive heart failure.
Lot of comorbidities were there.
Lot of comorbidity, and probably it was intervened at a very, very late time, probably very late time. Now, any questions from our Bangladesh faculty? Important. Our Bangladesh faculty wants to comment something.
Even the Kolkata doctors. Can you raise your hand how many of you do measure aortic valve area in continuity equation? Very good. Only few.
We find it always difficult to measure the VTI and other things for stroke volume. In majority of the time, I don't think it tallies with the measurement. Also, we find it difficult to have the continuity equation done for the measurement of valve area. In a real practice, real life, what we are doing, I'm producing the fact to you. And I'm also interested in knowing how much time is required for evaluation of a prosthetic valve in your day-to-day practice. That is my question.
Now this is very relevant because in a Ecolab with a very heavy workload, a prosthetic valve is a big challenge. But I think it is better that you spend at least half an hour to get entire data of this patient, because otherwise there's a complete confusion about management. Second thing is this, if you average the LVOT VTI and aortic VTI for multiple beats, your errors go down. The error we introduce is by the LVOT diameter. That is the big problem. But thereafter, you don't have to do the measurement because the machine does the measurements. Because generally, the formulas are fed into the machine. If you can tell your application specialist, he always puts the formulas inside. So you don't have to really worry. You have to just give the diameters and you have to just give the VTIs and the entire stroke volume. And if you have put the body surface area, the height and weight, index to body surface area and stroke volume, everything comes. So we really don't have to spend time in calculation.
But it is being said that the diameter of LVOT is not very, it is not accurate all the time. You may need to magnify the LVOT and again measure it for several times to get real measurement of the LVOT to get the stroke volume.
Yeah, so it's perfectly a valid point that the LVOT diameter is a big problem. Generally, the largest one that you get, you may be using it, but I think the best would be probably that you get the LVOT area on a 3D, okay, because we know that it is oval, so it pi r square cannot be used. And the area the diameter that we are measuring is actually the small axis of that oval. That's why I showed the CT image. So I think it is better that we get the cross-sectional area of LVOT either by CT or by a 3D echo and use that area into VTI to get the stroke volume. And probably when you use that, I think many of those low flow may become normal flow gradients.
Yeah.
So what is your final recommendation? So any case of calcified aortic valve, you must do the 3D echo or CT, compulsory or not?
See, my problem is that I seriously tried to do the 3D echo LVOT area in this calcific aortic stenosis, but I've never been very happy with the way I get the images. Some of those images are not very good. Of 3D LVOT. I mean, the images of 3D are always excellent for mitral wall. Somehow they are not good for the aortic wall or for the LVOT. Because on 3D data, you can actually be perfectly perpendicular to LVOT. You can see it in fast. But the problem is that still the clarity or the sharpness is so poor that you really don't know whether you are measuring the correct LVOT or not. Secondly, if you change the gains in the azimuthal plane, or that means in the elevation, okay, then also many times some tissue is lost or you gain some tissue or there are tissue dropouts, then again there is a problem of measuring the LVOT area. So I think the CT or the MR is much better in that. Or I think other way one can do is that you do a 3D LV volume and then get the stroke volume from that and immediately put it for the numerator. Don't go into the business of LVOT VTI and LVOT cross sectional area, just get the stroke volume from 3D LV volumes and then try to use it there.
Actually, a CT autogram is required in some of the patient where the component of regurgitation is there, and you need to plan whether this patient needs a aortic root replacement also or not. Sometimes you get a surprise on the table and you are not prepared financially.
That is well accepted.
You need so actually this should be a protocol in some of the cases.
Some of them, as he rightly said, that the roots may be dilated and you are anyway going to do CT. So in that case, I think you can have the CT or LVOT area and you can have a proper measurement of stroke volume.
So you do not know beforehand which patient will behave like in the OT table. So it's I think it's a now it is a mandatory in any calcified
should
to do the CT.
Correct. No, see, because the thing is, you take the velocity time integral from Doppler, but you take the LVOT area from the CT. Okay, and probably you will get much better stroke volume, and probably many of them may not be really low flow.
So you have advised the redo aortic valve replacement
to the Mrs. B.
Why didn't you advise a mitral creep for the mitral valve? It was moderate to severe MR.
No, this is about the lady number one now, who was having severe MR.
Severe lady number one.
Yeah, she was the first lady A, Mrs. A. But there she was max, so the clip will not work. Yeah, clip will not work. And the other lady had got a very good OMB result, and she had a very mild mitral regurgitation. So I think mitral wall was not culprit.
No, TAVR is one.
No, but if you look at the echo, she has still very high LA pressures.
Pardon?
The second lady, she still has very high pressure, LA pressures. Just look at the echo and you will see that the…
No, LA the LA is dilated because she was mitral stenosis
not
patient.
Not really dilated, pressure overload.
No. See, the LA size is related to her long-standing mitral stenosis. But then there is, how will you know about the pressure overload? Because it's a remodeled LA because of a long-standing mitral stenosis. So the LA volume has no role in telling us the LA filling pressures. And rather, if you see her mitral Doppler, that was perfectly fine with a rapid E deceleration time. So, I mean, hardly any gradient across mitral leaflet.
Sir, I think that time is up, sir, and you have a flight to take.
Pardon?
Sir, the time is up and you have a flight to take, sir.
Please, thank you. Give a big hand to boss Nitin, and we are all happy to end it here. Shorang Shodha Kiju Balada Chen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nitin Murkule, for your such extensive knowledge sharing session.